Conservation Coalition. For those of you who don't know us, we are the fiscal organization of Broadbrook Coalition, and we really applaud the amazing efforts that this Gerald Lake. Our parcels of land and the places that we steward are a little smaller than Gerald Lake, so we work with the city to hold conservation restrictions on pieces of land on the Connecticut River Greenway, a couple of pieces at Sheldon Field, Montview, and the Hutchins Trail, which is behind the College Church at the Conway Terrace. And we are a younger organization, so we are encouraging membership. Please look at the flyer that we printed, and we hope you'll join us as members. A couple of highlights from this year that I just wanted to let you know about. One we're particularly excited about, and I hope to give a shout out to Mr. Joe Bender, who's sitting right there. The Hutchins Trails, if you haven't seen those, behind the College Church, Joe has been doing amazing work with hordes of wonderful volunteers to clean up and really mark off those trails. He's the recipient of a wonderful grant that will allow him to continue doing these things, and it's just a great effort, so I hope you get a chance to have a look.
We're hoping to get to the vote.
Absolutely. Joe, do you want to state where...
I'm glad to be here. I have my first MC3. Is it okay to call it MC3?
Yes.
My first MC3 meeting. We met at the library. There was a nice presentation by the guy that did construction along the Connecticut River Valley. Really great. That's where I met James. And at that time, I had just been working on the trails by myself with students. But we heard that the state was going to turn over that property to the city. And once we realized that they were going to do that, that was a great opportunity to go to the conservation board and get permission to expand the little trails, little walking trails that we had, and triple the size of it. So over the last couple of years, we've been kind of working on doing that, and then building up a neighborhood volunteer group. And then we found, and then MC3 said that they would be glad to help out managing the area. So I'm really, really glad that an organization like that that's just starting to grow has joined in, because I thought I was going to be the only one working on the trails and managing them. Now we have all these people that are involved, and it's just going to grow and grow and grow, I hope. We do need more people to use the trails. It would be nice to see more people back there, and we also need to build up our list of volunteers that can come on Saturdays and do some work on the trails, because it is a floodplain forest, which is also unique compared to the other trails. You know, we have Robert Hill and Minnow Springs and Sawmill Hook, but this is really the only floodplain forest trail system that is now, that now has the city support as well. And like James said, we just applied for a grant with the Department of Conservation and Recreation, and we got almost $17,000. For a little trail, system like this, it's just going to help us move, you know, into the next level. We're hoping to put in a small little wheelchair accessible portion. We're working with College Church. I work at Technical Programs. I'm a history teacher there. We're working with College Church, and I'm hoping to get Bridge Street School on board as well to create a little butterfly garden trail in between the transition between the field and the woods. So there's a lot of plans for the future. Over the next 2 years, we're going to be using that grant money to make the trails more permanent. Most of it has wood chips on it to protect, try and keep the trail under control, because it grows back fast every spring. I don't know, that's about all I have to say. Is there any other questions?
Well, yeah, can you park at College Church?
You can park right there. If you go behind College Church, there's a big parking lot back there. That everybody's welcome to. Sundays is kind of busy, but the rest of the week is pretty open.
So how long will it take?
I would say we haven't really clocked it off, because kind of there's a perimeter trail, and then there's a smaller interior trail that's been the main trail for all these years, and then there's some other winding trails that kind of connect the inner trail to the perimeter trail. So in total, I would probably say maybe 2 miles at the most. It's not blazed yet. That's one of the next steps that we need to move. But it's fairly clearly marked. Right now, with all the leaves on the ground, it's not as easily marked. And when there's snow on the ground, again, it's again, it would be hard to follow. So we do need to blaze it and put up signage. But in the spring, up until the leaves do fall, it's very clearly defined. You can see wood chips, and you can see their borders of fallen limbs that we've pulled out and then put all on the side of the trail. So the wheelchair accessible route is going to be about a quarter of a mile. All right?
Can you tell us, show on the map maybe where it is? I don't think where it is.
Well, I'm legally blind, so I can't do it, but somebody could probably do it. Early 70s, it was the Northampton School for Girls, and that whole forest back there was actually all athletic fields that the girls' school had. There was field hockey, and there was even clay tennis courts, and the old fence posts are still up back there. Then it's through forest natural succession. The woods have grown back since nobody was using it, but at one time it was pretty well groomed. So there's a lot of invasive species that we also need to deal with. There's an old fire pit back there that the girls use for some rituals. So it's historically it's pretty interesting as well as naturally it's pretty interesting, and it's a good place to walk dogs and get away just if you're in Ward 3.
I don't know if this helps him, but there's a tree canopy, an imaginable tree canopy that one goes through to get to the dike called the Pomeroy. From the first segment of the dike, you can look down and you can see the trail network. Quite beautiful, but pretty well connected.
No, and there's another one down.
Yeah.
We're working on getting more access points off the dike, but that's in the future.
Thank you for the exciting project. Well, I know we've all come to learn about the birds in the meadow, and we're very lucky to have our wonderful speaker tonight. I'm going to have Fred Zimnick, who is our secretary, introduce our speaker. Thank you.
My name is Fred Zimnick, and I was fortunate enough to get Scott to talk to us. The Connecticut River Meadows is important to our community. It was important to Native Americans to use it to plant maize at our annual meeting in 2012. Professor Christopher Clark told us that the early settlers also planted sorghum and broom corn. Today, many of the crops are planted there, including potato crops. If you were bird flying high over U.S. Route 91, which you can almost make out on the map, you would see that Route 91 bisects our meadows, and in the east and west portions, with the former mainly farmland and the latter grassland. Northampton is a diverse community, so it's important and satisfying to learn about our neighbors. We share the middle of a large bird community that is as diverse as our city. Scott Cerner, who has been birding for decades, is the president of the Hampshire Bird Club. He has lectured at the club and taught birding at Hitchcock Center. He has graciously consented to come here today and talk to us about our neighbors that live or frequently visit the meadows. Scott, can you tell us about our avian neighbors?
All right. Well, thank you for having me. You wouldn't believe how resistant Fred is. He's good. Once he gets holy, he'll fall into it. All right. We're going to talk mainly about East Meadows. It's an area of Northampton, probably about a couple thousand acres worth of farmland. anyone here been to East Meadows for various things? Everybody? Okay. Alright, East Meadows, like I said, makes up this general area right in here. Over the years, there's been over 200 species of birds sighted in this region. Because it's along the Connecticut River Flyway, and massive open area, it just attracts a lot of birds. A lot of us go there in spring, summer, and the fall, I mean, spring, winter, and the fall. Summertime is a little quiet out there because of the growing season. Most of the crops that I've ever seen out there are corn and potatoes, cases of squash fields pop up. But on the edge of the meadows, areas like here, the woodland areas, the quick pasturings, this area out here, open land birds, along the river over here, waterfowl. So there's a nice diversity there. So if you have questions as we go along, you can raise your hand.
I'm just curious on that map, where is the Coolidge Bridge that I'm on?
I think it's right here.
Okay.
It's right there.
And where's 91?
I think this is 91 right here.
Okay.
Northampton Airport, right here. Yeah, around this.
That's the former Sterling Field?
Where? In the meadows?
Yeah.
I think there's a little bit out there. I've never seen a lot out there. Mostly I've ever seen out of the
airport. Where's the landing strip here for the airport?
Right in this area here. Yeah. And in this area here is an area known, yeah, terms I've given you tonight are birding terms. Mm-hmm. You might know some of these areas by another name, but I'm giving it to you like how us birders refer to this area. This area over here is West Meadows with Arcadia and the Oxbow. Another major area is the cavity over here in the growing area of honeycomb. That whole region right here is pretty terrific. Do you want to get? Well, this is just about right here. Yep. If you look at the light there. Down a little bit. Bathrines, things like wrens, vireos, warblers, that part. Alright, this is a look from the Mount Holyoke, Scanner State Park. You can see there's obviously a big growing here for corn in this particular year. You have the woods over here, which is good for the warblers and such, out here for poor birds, geese at times. Every time here is a little bit different. The look from the meadows in the fall and in the winter time, this area here is good for waterfowl, right down in Connecticut. And lots of in the fall, if you've ever been down the meadows along the river, sometimes thousands of Canada geese will spend the winter there. They head up to 4,000 or 5,000 in that general region. I don't tend to see them out in the meadows as much as I used to, but right along the river here. Waterfowl itself, there's probably over 20 species of waterfowl been sighted in the region. Well, I think it's depending on where, how high you're seeing them. If you see some that are really migrating, you see a nice deep pattern. If it's kind of going low from one cornfield to the other, well, there's a lot more sedentary. You know, there's a lot more hanging around here when you're coming down from the north. And that, in the old days, as they say, when you used to see them just streaming through. And now they're doing very well in Western Mass, breeding and throughout the movement. And the movement is still getting a lot coming down from the far north, but still getting, unless it gets really cold and river freezes, you're getting a good group of them hanging in. Other ones you hope for are snow geese that occasionally mix in. Now it's interesting being right here in the Connecticut River Valley, we don't get snow geese a whole lot. In the right weather pattern, it might force a group down, but a lot of times they just go right through us. You drive 3 hours up to Lake Champlain, up in Addison, Dead Creek region of Vermont. That's one of their holdover areas where they're coming down out of the Arctic. Right now there's 4,000 or 5,000 up there. So,
but we barely ever get those kind of numbers here. It has to be the right weather pattern to knock them down and push them off course in order for us to get those numbers. The only thing, the only time we ever come close was fill up in Sunderland, probably 15 years ago, we had 6,000 or 8,000 come down. Other ducks we can encounter on the river, bobbleheads. And one thing the Meadows has these two man-made ponds here. And in the early spring, can be good for, you know, for dancers, other diving ducks, mallards, pintails, that sort of thing. And this little strip out here, this little strip in the springtime, they just get inundated with water ducks. There have been counts of 800 mallards out there, 200 ringling teal, 50, you know, widgeons, I mean, all kinds of stuff. The trick is, you gotta be one of the first ones there, because by the time you get there, you've got 500 ducks going into the air. So, but that little strip that floods every year out here in the meadow.
Does it have a name?
It does not.
Are you here every year?
Just about. If there, I mean, unless it's a little dry spring and this doesn't, you know, it doesn't flood, you know, but every year that whole area floods and, you know, you get there early morning and it can be amazing. Like I said, we do just one or two people once they just go. And then they head over to the Hadley Cove or other parts of the river and they start to leave.
Can you
guys
tell how
high
it is?
I'm sorry. Your question.
Is that Elwell?
No, Elwell is up here.
Okay.
Yeah,
can you explore your house with that little strip of water?
Right here. I think that.
No.
What? Oh, right here?
Yeah.
Well, I think you were coming in off of Hawkins Road, off of
okay.
Route 5 over here.
Uh-huh.
And then you park here, there's roadways going out there, and you know, you just got to kind of find it a few times. But, ooh, blue ducks will show up in great numbers. Blue ducks have been doing well over the last several years, thanks to, you know, the beavers created a lot of habitat for them in the last 25 years. Put in for gansers. These guys have also done very well, locally, as the beavers. Now, out in the meadows, a few years ago, aside from that strip of water that I pointed out, other areas, if you get heavy rains, areas can flood, these are just woodland teal here, but any ride you come over, any plenty of cornfield, you just, you know, get into August, September, October, you're full of ducks. Now, what's done really well, as a lot of you probably know, in the last 25 years, the American bald eagle. At one time, it was a real treat to see a bald eagle away from the flogging river. Now, you're nesting over in Honeypot, you're nesting down the river near South Abbey, Northampton region, up in Curtis Falls. There's five, I think, active nests at Flogging. So they're doing quite well. And it's amazing you get a chance to watch these guys move around up and down the river and hunt. They love to go after waterfowl. They also love woodchucks and muskrats and other various. It's just amazing though how when the ducks, when the eagle flies over, then, you know, things just scatter. Just scatter. And of course the breeding is the immature bald eagle. It takes them about 4 years or so to attain the adult plumage. That white head and that white tail. Yeah. Typical shot of the meadows. One thing I stress to people is if you're going out in the meadows, you know, you've got to watch these roadways. These things can be really, really treacherous. I stop at the barn out there. If I think, you know, I just don't want my cover to fall me out. I mean, this is just, it can be horrendous out there. And then, of course, in the really dry season, you come back with about 5 pounds of dust all over your car. But you got to watch the roadways when you go out there.
out the meadows, in power lines, look for barn swallows and tree swallows, and especially in late August. It can be, every year is different out there. Every season, could be crops, whatever they're planting, but tree swallows, for example, about 10 years ago, there were estimates anywhere from 60 to 100,000 tree swallows gathered. But since then, we've had no numbers near them. Don't know why. But yeah, you can get numbers of barn swallows out there, bank swallows, cliff swallows on occasion, and on rare occasions, a purple martin might show up.
Are the wings the telltale sign for long wings?
The color here, this one doesn't really have a nice, you can't see this photo, it's probably a young bird, it's a very deep forked tail. But just the overall coloration of it.
Do you pass them through?
Yeah, well, yes. I mean, barn swallows nest here in Western Mass. Mm-hmm. They arrive probably late April as a rule, and they will depart, late September, somewhere in there. They're working their way down south to Texas. Other raptors, Cooper's Auk, taking advantage of the farm equipment. It was a real rainy morning and that bird was soaked beyond the ground. But they're out there hunting. Okay, that's a little overview of the airport area. This, I think this is the bridge over here.
Yep.
You've got, this is Ferry Street here. Come out right here, and then this is Northampton Airport. This is called the airport years ago, for those who've been around a while. The airport, I read the other day, was started in 1929. If you believe everything you read, Lindbergh even used the airport. And he was with his girlfriend at the time. So, this airport area can be really good in the winter time. Here's the shore here. This roadway comes down, just goes out to like a golf cart racing track or something out there. It's good vantage points of the river right there. These trees can be good for smaller birds like the platypus, sparrows, the warblers. Occasionally at dusk, you might see a long-eared owl before. This road here, you come through, you go straight out, and then come down here, you go out to probably a little while of the barn. But, excuse me, I'll lose it. And again, the airport. Sometimes you get meadowlarks out here, in non-breeding season. But in the winter time, another look at the airport. In the winter time, what we hope for is things like longspurs. These birds breed in the Arctic, and they come down in the fall, and generally stay throughout the winter in small numbers. The most they've ever had is 28 at one time. A little bit of color left in this bird, probably a male. There's black right in here, and then this wings right in here. They're cool little birds. You basically only get one species here in Massachusetts or New England, and that's the Lapland longspur. There are other state records for other longspurs, but few and far between. That's what they look like in the summertime, and you see them in Alaska. There's quite a difference that goes on. They're really spectacular. Short-eared owls. In recent years, there's been a couple hanging around just north of the Honeypot, but they're also seen in the East Meadows. They've also been seen in the West Meadows, usually late fall through the winter, early spring is when we have our best shot. Now, meadows are used for lots of things. Hiking, walking, running, walking your dog, and sometimes having your dog walk you. I mean, I think these are sled dogs. I had to do a double take one day. This thing is not running. The dogs are pulling him throughout the meadow. I've seen him out there a few times. And the dogs are pretty happy when I see him.
They're practicing for the Iditarod.
I guess so.
Well, they really are.
Yeah.
the landmark is, a part of it anyway. Slowly losing its size, so it's not quite as great as it used to be. And of course, meadows are used for hunting, which is fine, but you just gotta, I was out there on the road on that side, all these people had already started coming out of the corn, I'm not leaving my car too far. So I guess they're hunting pheasants this time of year. It's funny, as much time as I spend out in the meadow, I can't tell you the last time I saw a pheasant. I know that, but you think you see some, but unless they all get them the first day, they stop. Yeah. Oh, yeah. They have to. There's no really wild pheasants anymore. There's no two good gamers if you say a wild or a rough grouse. Anyway, so you gotta show, you gotta be a little careful out there. This is the red barn, but you know, every year's a little different. Sometimes the vegetation is really intense around here, and it'd be a good place for small birds, and wrens, and I don't know, chat here, the warbler, the bear warbler. Cardinals will pop up from time to time. Funny about cardinals, you go back to the 1940s, 1950s, cardinals were rare birds here. On the mockingbird and stuff like that. And now they're everywhere. Rose-breasted grosbeaks, they arrive in early May and depart generally end of September. Sometimes we'll have some lingering, there's a few lingering in here and there, but the majority of them take off. This is a nice male.
Are they called grosbeak?
Grosbeak.
Large.
Yep.
So, when they come here, what do they eat?
Well, in the summertime, I've had them at my feeder a number of times. They eat the sunflower seeds. But I'll eat the insects, whatever they can, you know, scatter. Seeds, you know. But that's an amazing peep right there. Yeah. It's a real peep right there. This is what they look like in the fall.
That's the male?
That's probably a young male, but that's eventually what they're, females, what typically females look like, young males. Mm-hmm. And males will start to lose their plumage. Eastern phoebes, very common flycatcher here in the valley. I'm nesting on my porch. They breed this year. They breed pretty sensitive. Very determined little birds. So anyway, they start arriving in late March, early ones, April, and then mid-October they start to move on out. Occasionally get them on Christmas bird counts around here. We had vireos. Again, they don't nest in the meadows area, they nest in the higher terrain, but in bird migration, come right to our region. Also, the little brother vireos had out there, Philadelphia vireos. Vireos are kind of neat, they have nice, all the vireos have blue teeth right now.
Let's make them from the blue ones.
Uh-huh. I use a 300 and I have a 500. The 500 is under tri-fi most of the time. Not the 3, I can't pull that. But I take the 500 out when I'm on a mission, you know, the 500 is pretty heavy. So tri-fi, they probably weigh about, 16 pounds. All in all, that's a lot. So, American Robins, Sumac, Ospreys. Quite common during migration along the Connecticut River, among the meadows. I've seen them fishing, hunting on the Connecticut. I've seen them bathing out there. Magnificent birds. They don't really nest now in Western Mass. There was a nest down at the Biggie Fairground about 5 years ago. Nested for a couple of years. That was the first one in decades. But they haven't gone back there now. So. These were the two migrants that come through our region. American kestrels, You have an old field guy tucked away, you might say Sparrowhawk, that's American Kestrel. Kestrels have, unknown reasons, have really taken a beating in New England. Their numbers have dropped over 60%. I'm trying to get a little time to that number. But they do nest in the valley, so people have tried to bring back the numbers. And Kestrel boxes, you may see them up in different fields and along the highway. But, you know, people were sharpshin hawks.
What kind of hawk?
Sharpshin.
Sharpshin?
Yeah, it's an exhibitor. It's interesting, about 30 years ago, they looked at sharpshin hawks around here. That first photo I showed you with Cooper Shop on the farm equipment, those birds have really taken over, and sharpshin have dwindled in terms of breeding, and they go farther north. Cooper is just kind of like, transplanted themselves in there. But they're exhibitors. Exhibitors have short rounded wings, longer tails, good for maneuvering through bushes and trees and such. Red tail hawk, very common hawk along 91, along the fields of Hadley, Northampton. They're doing quite well. Broadwing hawk. Again, that's a bird that does nest in the region. People will go up to the top of Mount Tom, Mount Holyoke, Skinner State Park in the spring and the fall, hoping to get that big day when we get a couple thousand come through. And if you're out down in the meadows, I've had days where you can be early in the morning when the sun hits and they're starting to lift off. They got set down the night before, and I've had, you know, 100, 200 start to go up. So it's pretty cool. Yeah. Those are all broadwing hawks there.
And where did you find this picture?
In the meadow. You're not as big as a red tail, for example. Now, the interesting thing, when you guys get cranked up, now in Massachusetts, there's a few lookouts that have come close, and one day they've had like 20,000 in a day. But as these guys get moving, they're going to funnel themselves down through Texas. And then into Mexico. And you go down to the river of raptors down there, down in Veracruz, Cardell. And if you have a really good day, you'll see 500,000 broadwings in a day. And if you have a really, really good day, all the planets are aligning. They've had some days where they've had a million come through. So.
So what are they eating though?
Eggs, roads, yeah, lizards, yeah. I've often wondered if the same thing happens down there with all the vultures coming down. You see thousands and thousands of turkey vultures. If you drive around, you don't see any dead stuff. You know, they must be flying a lot of dead things to eat down there, but I mean, there's just literally thousands of vultures that are cruising through there.
So are they like reptiles? Can they go for a long time after one meal without eating?
I don't think so.
Well, depending on migration, they can certainly migrate in 200 to 300 miles a day. Whether they, you know, I would think they would try to eat if they could, you know. I mean, it's not like some of the shorebirds and stuff that, you know, leave Alaska and fly for, you know, 10,000 miles over the ocean to get to the next spot, you know what I mean? So I would think they would give them the opportunity. Okay, what else we have here? Okay, just another overview of the meadows here. Just another general overview of the meadows. This area over here, this is, I guess, is Rainbow Beach. To be honest with you, I never really spent any time in this woods here. I think there's obviously down the meadows, you have to be careful. There's private property down there. So, you know, how you get there, I don't know, but I've just never really birded a whole lot down there following the trespassing sign. How about the meadows themselves? You know, personally, I've never been bothered. I mean, you stay out of the farmer's fields if they're planting their crops and stuff, you know, common sense stuff. And I, you know, like I said, I've led many a trip out there, and, you know, but I know at least the time it's a little friction. If that's a good word.
Roadways out there on public roadways?
I mean, I've been going out here, some aren't, but I guess that's part of the debate. But I mean, just in general, I, you know, I mean, I have to stop this back, environmental police. You know, it's just, again, if you're, I don't know, I just never been really bothered out there. I mean, you stay on the roadways, you know, go out four-wheeling through farmers' crops and everything, and then, like I said, you come and says, how it will develop down the road, I don't know, but there have been, like you said, some friction in certain areas in the road.
In the upper right-hand corner of the picture, it looks like there's some crop seeds.
Well, I'm sure there's some alien thing going on, yeah. Is that right? Okay, so away from the hawks, and is, you know, you do go out there for warblers and other, you know, grosbeaks and cardinals and all top sort of things. This is a common yellow throat, the warbler. It is a fairly common warbler here in Western Mass. It's a nice male, got a nice black mass, yellow throat. Sometimes you get dozens of them at times out there, other times, you know, one or two. They can make it through, you know, there are a few records in December, but the majority of them are like push on. Black-throated green warbler. Yeah, this is a migrant through the Meadow area. Over the years, there's been over 23 species of warblers found out there. Again, a lot of people in the springtime necessarily don't go out to these meadows looking for warblers, but certainly that cover they have out there, you can certainly turn a bunch of them up. Go ahead. Magnolia warbler. Interesting thing about eastern wood warblers, people come from England and other places in Europe in the springtime to see our woodwork. They don't occur anywhere else in the world. Nest in New England, up into, you know, Canada, and migrate back down into South America. But yeah, people come from Europe, they design their vacation just to coincide with the migration of the warblers. Oh, yeah.
What
date
for their.
I'm sorry?
What are the best dates for warblers?
Well, in general, they, you know, some of them start arriving in the second week of April. The first, the yellow rungs, the palm warblers, and as you get into about the second, third week of May, that's just about the peak time when they're coming through. They will keep migrating right through the end of May, but that's, you know, about peak time. Black and white warbler. Yellow rung warbler, very common. This bird is one of the first ones to arrive in the spring. And it can linger into the winter time too, especially along the coast. Beautiful male. In the fall, they lose all this color, but one thing yellow rung always has is the yellow rung. It always has the yellow rung. They lost all that color in the fall. A little bit less green here in the shoulder, but very common bird. American Red Star. A young Red Star, probably a young male. Palm Warbler. And these guys arrive in late April too. Interesting thing about palm warblers, you get two races. You get eastern race, which people refer to as yellow palm, nice yellow underneath. And you get the western race, which is no yellow. It's interesting, we get mostly yellow palms in the spring, but in the fall, we tend to get to the western.
Are warblers named warblers because of their song?
No, I don't think so. Can't give you that exact answer.
Now, it seems like a lot of these warblers were sort of small and cubby, you might say. Bigger stomach and.
Just putting in where the wind would be puffed up a little bit. Uh-huh. It's hard to tell. They all kind of look. You're not going to see any great difference on them.
I mean, just to tell, there's a lot of little birds.
There are. There's lots yelps, tee up. You know, they go, choo, done. Yeah. I don't know. You just can't identify every one of them. There's a bunch that get away. Leaves, they drop down. Now, sometimes it's weird that you select a surrounding bush, you're like, it's tunneling, you know? So, flickers. Flickers are pretty common. Woodpecker. This is a northern flicker. This is a male. This is my old name of yellow shafted flicker. You see the bright yellow underneath and in the tail, and we'll do that a little bit more. And again, out in the fields here, I think you can just wash field, cut the corn out here. Summertime, like I said, it's just stuff out there, then you get some desert sparrows and such, song sparrows, things like that, but it's fairly kind of quiet, you know, out in that channel, really doing stuff, not like the spring and fall. Males, seen coyotes over there a few times, not very often. That's about the only one, you know, the only large animal, that animal, except the alpaca. I came around the corner the other day, and out in the middle of the road was this alpaca. I was like, this guy. So, knocked on the door, and I was like, real nice people. And I said, he gets out. He just go right through the water. So he goes, okay. Well, he'll come back. I said, okay. They're cute. Probably not native for these guys.
What should he
do? Yeah, perhaps. He's taking it this fall, so could be some bears. Worm vireo. Pretty common bird during migration and common breeder here in Western Mass. Not much to it, really. It's pretty drab looking thing. And then in the fall, what birders hope for in the fall, generally speaking, the fall is better, is shorebirds. Now, you go down to Cape Cod, you go to Newburyport, Plum Island, you'll see thousands and thousands of shorebirds. Shorebirds are small, generally long-legged, fairly long-billed birds. Breed in the Arctic, work the mud, looking for worms and such. But here in Western Mass, we have to work for them to get some. They come through, but usually in ones and twos, we get lucky sometimes, you might have 20 or 30. But a lot of times we have to wait for inclement weather. They're migrating, you get a storm that comes in, and then they rain and such force them down. It could be just fantastic. Those days of farming. So what we do out in these meadows, the farmers are done harvesting, they plow it all down, and get a little rain, that's the time you hope for the shorebirds to show up. Things like Wilson snipe will make an appearance occasionally. They don't, possibly a rare breeder in the valley, maybe up in the temperatures, but mostly look farther north to Vermont and New Hampshire, Maine, those areas there. Real long bill, a plump bird. Dunlin, really great trap bird. And one thing that we never get to see very much, the birds here in New England, for the most part, we don't get to see the high breed equivalent of some of these shore birds. You go along the coast when the adults are just coming back from the Arctic, sometimes you see some really good ones. Occasionally you do, but for the most part, they're going into their winter plumage. Now, this is a dunlin in the springtime. His back is all red with a black belly. He's a gorgeous bird. He's a nice ruby bill here. Good bird here in the valley, in what's known as a good spot. Lesser yellow legs, come through, they're reasonably common, shorebirds, you know, spending some time out in the field, you can come upon them. Setting pollinated clovers, again, these are birds that aren't nesting here in the valley. Or these birds are nesting in the yard. Solitary sandpiper. This bird here is actually pretty cool. It's a golden, American golden plover. And this is by far, I took this, seen a number of them in these meadows over the years. This is what happened in the academy 2 years ago. This by far is the best golden plover in terms of plumage I've ever seen. Most of the time, all this black is gone, the whole deck. So this bird is pretty close to a golden plumage bird. I've been birding almost 40 years, I guess. That's the best one. So these guys are remarkable. They will just leave the Arctic and they will just, you know, bad weather or whatever, but they'll force them down at times. Sometimes, a lot of times you might see two or three out there. Once in a while, you might get it. You might get 40, 50, 60 that put down all at once. Killdeer? Killdeer is a short bird that nests in the meadows and in the valley. Close. And this is top of ball. You know, another solitary sandpiper. This guy is another one that he's hoped to find in the fall. This bird did not come up our into the meadows in the springtime. So it's actually a very rare bird in eastern North America in the springtime. They go right up to the center of the country. In the fall, they swing around and come down through the wing. This is a buck breasted sandpiper. This guy nests right up at the Arctic Circle. And an amazing bird. He will travel thousands of miles into South America. So it's just amazing. From the migration to southern Greater yellow legs. 7-pollinated sandpiper. They did, this is basic plumage, winter plumage bird. Years ago, with the Nanomet, in Plymouth area, and they captured one of these and banded it and let it go. Now, they do a lot of banding there, up in Appledore, they do a lot of banding in Maine and other areas. And it's always, from a bander's perspective, it's always fun when they get a report of a bird that someone else has caught in their nets. And several years ago, they released one in Plymouth, Mass. And 3 days later, it was 3,000 miles away. It was re-caught in South America. That guy wasn't stopping. He was going right over the ocean to them. So some of these guys can really put on some amazing conditions.
And he didn't need to travel to the wind current?
Like anything else, weather's got to be with them. If they're going to be running into a storm or something, they're going to be put down. And,
but, I mean, they're not majestic.
No, they're not. They're not that high. They're not that high. But it's just amazing what they can do. These sandpipers, like yellow legs, these guys. This is a juvenile, a lot of color in this bird. Yeah, you get shorebirds and birds out on the open fields, you might get one of these guys. This is a peregrine falcon. This bird had also decimated from DDT, and it has come back. It has come back strong. It nests at Mass. It nests at Sugarloaf down in Springfield. I think it nests at Mount Palm. They're doing really well. I can remember first starting out, you would have to spend days at times at Goat's Peak at Mount Palm hoping that peregrine would fly by. Not anymore. They were doing very, very well. Once you got DDT out of the system.
It's an awesome
sight. It must have been an awesome sight when you're chasing that flock of shorebirds you're not seeing. And it's a juvenile peregrine. Really? another, it's, again, it's in the Falcon family, a little bit smaller than the Peregrine. And Merlin's a funny thing. This is a bird that is traditionally nesting much farther north. Now it's coming down. A lot of the birds are starting to go from the south going north because of climate change. So they're getting, things starting to progress moving up towards us. But this guy is coming, nested in Northampton a couple times, or nested up in danger. So it's a fun bird to watch though. It's the power, he's stopping down, and the speed is amazing.
When do they believe that in here?
Just individual species, so we can separate them. But falcons, you know, have pointed wings, very fast flyers. They're not the type of bird you're going to see probably in a wooded area, a suburb right here hunting like through the streets. That might be a chipper, like a Cooper's Dog or a Sharpton in general. They let the bird a little bit more open country. They're going to surprise things with the running down with their neck. House wrens. Common bird here. Common bird at times in the meadows during migration. Now, one thing that is, I don't have a photo of tonight, but in the early spring and again in the fall, sometimes you get thousands of blackbirds going into the corn. Redwings, by far, grackles, cowbirds, occasionally, on rare occasions, we'll get a yellow-headed blackbird, bird from out west. We've been reports of brewer's blackbirds, another blackbird from out west. So, but they do thousands at that time, especially in the spring, when it's just coming in. Now, for some people, the robin was like harbinger of spring. Not for me, it's the red ones. And they start coming back in full force. That's how the spring is on its way. Especially now, a lot of robins will winter over.
Yeah.
Northern Harriers. Rare breeder, and usually it's just migration, you get them around here. Rare breeder, I think they possibly bred up in Windsor at the Marine Refuge. And they're suspected of breeding over in Westover Air Force Base.
I had one of those just in the woods behind my house, sitting on a branch looking at a squirrel that was like hanging and punching him. And it sat there you know, for, I don't know, like hours, just watching this squirrel. And it was informative.
I mean, again, typical weird things happen. People say, well, why doesn't this end? This is what the norm is. Birds always don't follow the norm. But this bird typically likes open fields. It likes just to glide over them and then drop right down on a prey. Is it a female?
Mm-hmm.
Now, in springtime, indigo bunnings, at times when they come in, they sing from 50-foot trees. Sometimes they'll show up in your bird feeders when they're first arriving on migration. Then it kind of just, you know, we kind of look for them. You don't see lots of them. And but they're stunning birds. They're just, you know, the males are just, you know, gorgeous. And then as the fall blows around, they start hanging out in the corn. And sometimes you can get 30, 40, 50 indigo bunnings on a good day. It's just out in the corn. They've stopped, they're done breeding, and they're just starting to gather. And the males will move with blue as the fall progresses. And they'll end up looking something like this. No, yeah. No, I think you're just using whatever insects and what seeds perhaps are on these things that they're getting. I don't believe they're using the kernel. I've never seen it. Again, as we count every. In the meadows, every year is going to be a little different. Yes, you have your standard weed patches so that stay there year after year, but you know, the farmers come in and they move plow an area. So, every year can change a little bit. But the sparrows can be really good out in Meadow if they're in the fall. And there's like song sparrow, real common bird. Excuse me, year round resident. White red sparrow, typically spring and fall. They like to nest in higher elevations. But you can start to get tons of them in October out there. Swamp sparrows are kind of a funny thing. They come in the springtime, they go right for wet areas, marshes and boggy type areas. But in the fall, they forget all that and they just go out into the field. And sometimes you can go over 100 in a day, and have a really good day, and stop the field and go under here as well. But subtle, but pretty good. Vesper sparrows, really an uncommon breeder here, right in our region. And they nest over the honey pot, I think they nest in the meadows, nest up the hat field. Certainly, we got to the West Meadows too in Arcadia. All these sparrows are pretty blasé for the most part, brown, streaky, and popping and offer things to birds, you know, those of the burrows in the grass. They can drive you crazy, but a lot of fun. Lincoln sparrow, those colors. Look at those colors. This is, I got this home after I photographed it. But love that hairdo. Lincoln sparrows, they're definitely migrants. They don't nest in this region, and that's farther north. But spring and fall is a better time. Flame-colored sparrows, becoming more numerous over the last 20 years. Still a good bird. White crown sparrows. These folks come through in the spring and as well in the fall, and occasionally they'll hang in the winter time if you will, but for the most part they're in the farther south. The champion out there though is the Savannah sparrow. We get had 150, 200 birds at times. Just amazing numbers that have been found out there in the right circumstances. Again, brown streaky bird, little yellow in the eye, streaky crown, but out there by the birds. Golden crown kinglet, typically find them farther in spruce groves in the summertime, farther north. But around here, fall migration, they come down as they're moving through. Spring bird, there's a golden crown on this guy. American goldfinch loses its luster as the winter progresses. Not the bright yellow bird or the black cat that you see, but pretty common feeder bird too. As we get into the winter season, what we hope for is every few years these guys come down out of the Arctic and these are common red bulls. And they can invade the feeders, they can sometimes get 200 or 300 at a time out in the meadows, feeding on these tiny little seeds. Small food-type birds. American tree sparrow, another sparrow, but this bird only arrived in early November and departs sometime in late March, mid-April, as a rule. But this guy comes down from the higher elevation of the Newfoundland and Alaska and those areas. Hornwarts. Again, these are birds, when they're out looking for long spurs, that'll look through sometimes a few hundred of these guys in order to find a long spur. They're quite common out in the meadows and in years of heavy snow, when they plow the airport at Northampton, go down the runways, they'll expose the grass and lose all the birds and focus right on that area. Snow bunnies. Sometimes you can get, you'll see one, other times.
bright white with black lane. So, now there's a can on the background, striking burger, striking burger. See the one up here, snow lane. Now, the Meadows had, as they roughly the talk, the Meadows over the years have had a lot of rare birds also. They've had, on a couple occasions, deer falcons, which are the rare falcons in the north, Paris sparrows, sandhill cranes, several species of gulls, northern meteors, western kingbirds, blue grosbeaks. It's quite a list that for the Meadows area. Rough-legged hawk, again, this bird tends to start to show up maybe in early November, and sometimes they go through our region for other areas, other times they stay out the winter. Beautiful hawk, again, that's up in the way north, up in Alaska and into that area. You read back on, just amazing, you read in back in Elliot, the first attempt to read about it, published in 1937. You read accounts of these birds in the Meadows area. Back in the mid-1880s, they would go out, and one winter they collected 68, 78 leftover hawks. I mean, wild, wild west back then. And they just dropped them in blast birds. And it's funny, it's mentioned that after when we got past that time spell, no one's ever come close. I mean, I don't know how many could have been. They got 68, let's say. But, you know, they had to have missed a whole lot. So how many rough-legged hawks were once coming down to our area? Who knows? I've been birding almost 40 years, and the most I've ever seen at one time is 7. So, it's not fun to get used to, but hopefully that's getting better.
When you say they dropped them, you mean they were shooting?
They were shooting them.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah. Drop and collect them. Drop their buggies, horse-drawn buggies, and blast away. Yep. And it wasn't just hawks, it was other things too, if you realize. It was just looking back, you know, I mean, it was, back then, but looking at it now, it's just horrifying. But, okay, this is good. The first bird, first bunny. Finally, snowy owl. We had a massive year for snowy owls, best in decades, last year. And they're starting to show up again. Now, when I say us, I mean, most of it will go along the coast. But we had a few out here. Out here in Western Mass, snowy owls at times are just one-day wonders. There's already been one sighted down along Meadow. Days ago, went out in Sheffield, Mass. But the next day, no fun. They just kind of keep moving. But along the coast, they tend to stay put a little bit more, like at Plum Island, Westbury Beach, Cape Cod, up in the Maine and New Hampshire coastlines. I had a friend go out last year in late November and had a 22 one day. Amazing. Now, tell you how big the invasion of that bird. Other birds in Newfoundland went out. And in half a day, I got over 200. So they had a really good breeding season up there. Historically, the Meadows have been a pretty good place to find snow. But they can show up. They can show up in downtown Northampton on one of the buildings. But historically, the Meadows is a good place to look for the their ferocious. Oh, yeah. See, these things are, you know, keep your small children next to you. These things will take, Norm Smith's been doing, removing snowy owls and doing studies at Logan Airport for over 30 years now. And last year, he removed, when I say removed, he didn't shoot them. He didn't go to the group of the guys down at JFK down there when they were blasting up the room. That
backyard. He removes them because he's working with the Logan Airport, and they don't want him birds out there. So he goes, captures them, and releases them either at Duxbury Beach or Palm Island. And I'm sure they come back, but he captured over 100 ducks here.
How did he capture?
I can't remember. I've seen this program, it's so long ago, it's quite crucial.
Well,
yeah, some kind. I just don't know how he frames it. Put some prey in there and boom. He's witnessed them taking short-eared owls, black ducks, cormorants. You know what a cormorant is? Bird about this big. Great blue herons. Oh yeah, this bird is not to be messed with. Yeah, keep small pets next to you if you're out in the meadows and see snowing out. But they're gorgeous birds. We just had a nice program at our bird club on Monday night in the Navy's Day program, and his experience in the Arctic. And they found a snowy owl's nest with a short-eared owl alongside it, and king eider, lemons. I mean, they take anything. They are amazing animals. And there's been pelagic trips, pelagic birding off the coast of Massachusetts and New Hampshire. You could be out 20 miles, and in the wintertime, see this thing just gliding over the waves heading south. It's amazing.
Yeah. But he only attacks other birds, not rodents?
Oh, no. He'll eat rodents. He'll grab a squirrel, whatever. I don't think they're too picky. They're taking great blue herons, and they can certainly take a great squirrel. That's for sure. So Meadows is traditionally a good spot for them out there, but certainly you can't family and Meadows and that stuff. Maybe you show there. But most of the action that last winter was on the coast which is going on. But we did have a few around already, and they're already starting to show up again, so it's going to be interesting to see how many show up over this winter. But that invasion last year. The theory was that there wasn't enough food up there, so it was driving down. But now the theory has changed that the food was great up there, so they just multiplied like crazy. And now they're all branching out. Right. And there was a snowy owl last year lingering in Biddeford, Maine in July.
Where did you meet their nest?
Out just out of the tundra, just up
on the ground.
Yeah. Yeah, they're tundra nesters.
There's no trees out there.
Yeah. So, I believe that was my last slide.
Do they decorate?
Do they what?
Do something go after them?
Not that I'm aware of. I don't know if an eagle would nest with it. An eagle certainly is, a force to be reckoned with also. But I don't know what the interaction would be with the norm. But no, I can't do it.
Are there any questions or stuff?
Yeah, you just barely mentioned the 4 years ago, when I get to call it the West Meadow, over by the Oxbow, and literally there's like 50 something occupied in that.
Well, I know what you're saying. I think there was more nests than that. But there's also now a bald eagle's nest in that.
That's right.
Well, the neighborhood sometimes goes downhill, I just don't know how that's affected. But it was more than that. But I understand what you're saying. And I don't know what impact eagles have on that. There is. That never seemed to be an issue. That never, as far as I can tell, or heard, that never did do a great, great, beautiful setup. You can bring people there, put a scope on it, and you just get a great look at a great farm out. That's a great, great setup. I was under the impression there was a problem with the great moves and the great farm out, but now it's easy to do. I'm not so sure.
Well, yeah, it was fairly, they have had things like that. But when they were 50, it was
Oh, it's, yeah, it's great.
something that you, is that part of your expertise?
Well, I can identify a lot of them. I mean, if you throw me out west, I'm going to struggle for a little while, but around here, I'm pretty good at that.
Are there any guys
Yeah, there's lots of CDs and stuff you can listen to. There probably is.
Yeah, I'm sure there is.
Yeah,
I figured that out.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a big app person, but there's lots of CDs. It's probably true. Oh, there are apps. I mean, you've got the Sibley guy that has a version that has a song, which you can listen to right there. I know a lot of people have that, and the song and the recording is really good. Yeah, so that's the way to. It takes time. Time. I mean, you know, there's lots of, you know, I spent a couple of years ago leaving the hospital. It's kind of overwhelmed. You know, so it just takes time. You get the easy stuff first, the things that you're used to, you know, like the cardinal perhaps, the chickadees, a robin, a blue jay, you know, a quicker is pretty standard, you know, things like that. And you work at the sparrow and the warbird.
Why do you think that for the many of you, I think you know, students go across Africa, you know, why do you travel thousands of miles?
Why?
Yeah.
Different, I mean, some do, not all. I mean, just some of them, I mean, they're traveling up here for nesting purposes. I mean, there's a lot more space, you know, than probably all down in the tropics. The food supply also. I mean, the shorebirds are nest up in the Arctic, and when they're going up there, you know, tons of bugs, you know, tons of mosquitoes. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, yeah. They need it to feed their young. Mm-hmm. You know, same thing up in the forest. Food supply, habitat, you know, obviously habitat is an issue in both North and South America. Kind of win-win. You can make good strides in some areas, in other areas, you know, you can do better.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.